Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Final Exam by Carol J. Perry. Narrated by C.S.E. Cooney. Oh, what a tangled web we weave when first we practice to deceive. Sir Walter Scott. Chapter 1. As a field reporter for WICH-TV in my hometown of Salem, Massachusetts, I rarely report the news from an actual field. But on a sunny afternoon in early May, there I was, knee-deep in weeds, including some hay-fever-inducing goldenrod, chasing down a not-too-reliable lead. I'm Lee Barrett, nay Merrily Kowalski, 33, red-haired, Salem-born, orphaned early, married once, and widowed young. My aunt, Isabel Russell, I call her Aunt Ibby, raised me after my parents died, and we share the old family home on Winter Street with our cat, Orion. I'm WICH-TV's newest and youngest field reporter, and I know I have a lot to prove, to myself and to others, about on-the-spot breaking news reporting. That's why camerawoman Francine Hunter and I had just climbed partway up a steep hill, through a rusted barbed wire fence, past several beat-up no trespassing signs, and a couple of no swimming signs that looked as though they'd been used for target practice. I stumbled over a pile of empty beer cans, shiny bright colors gleaming through crabgrass and ragweed. Clearly, there'd been recent sign-ignoring trespassers in this bleak landscape besides us. I just hoped our source, Francine's roommate's brother's personal trainer, was right about what might be going on in the abandoned granite quarry just ahead. He said he'd overheard it in a dive shop. Something underwater, he'd said. Something the police were looking for. "Look," Francine whispered, pointing to a blue Chevy truck half hidden behind a small grove of maple trees. "Somebody braver than me drove on that god-awful, pot-holy, overgrown road and made it all the way up here. Maybe it's divers." "Bet it is. Anyway, I think leaving the station's only mobile van safely parked down on the street was the right thing to do," I assured her. "I'm sure our beloved station manager wouldn't enjoy sending a tow truck to rescue us if anything went wrong." "Oh, sure." Francine positioned her shoulder-mounted camera and started towards the Chevy. "Since Doan doesn't even know we're here, barring a van wreck, what could go wrong? We're trespassing on posted land trying to interview some divers who might be cops, who could be looking for something under a couple hundred feet of water, all on a tip from some guy's personal trainer we've never even met who hangs around in a dive shop." "Come on," I said. "Where's your sense of adventure?" "I think I left it in the van with the bug spray," Francine grumbled, aiming a swat at her ankle. "Let's get this over with." I gave the handheld mic a quick testing tap, adjusted the lanyard with my plastic-coated press pass on it, and hurried to keep up with her. She was right about the divers. As we drew closer to the blue truck, discreet lettering on the door was visible. SPD Dive Team. So, she was right about them being cops, too. My police detective boyfriend, Pete Mondello, had told me about these full-time police officers who volunteer to become divers so they can help in water rescue operations and even search underwater for evidence to help with investigations. "They really are looking for something, or somebody, in the quarry," I said. "And it looks like we're the only news team here." We pushed our way through weeds surrounding the maple trees and circled around the Chevy, emerging onto a broad ledge just a few feet above water. We were at the lowest possible access to the abandoned granite pit, facing a semicircle of geometric gray stone megaliths looming far above us like a vertical moonscape over the lake of blue water below. I took an involuntary step back. "Weird," I said with a little fake laugh. "Beautiful," Francine declared. "Look at that sunlight and shadow contrast." Stepping dangerously close to the edge of the wide outcropping where we stood, she panned her camera in a semicircular motion. Beautiful, she repeated. I squinted, still not moving any closer to the edge, my back to the Chevy, trying to see the beauty she saw in this dreary gray environment, which I'd probably soon need to describe for my audience. The voice came from directly behind me.
Hey, what are you doing here?
The man wore scuba gear, a dark blue wetsuit with two air tanks on his back. A mask dangled from his left hand. He walked toward me, flippers slap-slapping on the rough granite ridge. He didn't smile. I did, and lifted my ID badge to his eye level. Hi, I said, speaking into the mic. Lee Barrett, WICH-TV News. We had a call about SPD working up here today. How's the search going? Francine had moved closer to us, and I held the mic in his direction. He gave me a head-tilted, quizzical look, and didn't answer for a long moment. Dead air.
Oh, yeah.
Finally, he nodded.
Lee Barrett, I know you. Saw you with Detective Mandello at the Pal Pee Wee Thanksgiving hockey tournament.
Right, I said. Nice to see you again, Officer...
Andrews,
he said.
Bill Andrews.
He reached to shake hands, and I made a quick switch of the mic to my left and grasped his.
Hey, are we on TV now?
He glanced at Francine, frowning. WICH-TV News, I repeated. Not a live broadcast, just gathering material right now about the search. How's it going? I asked again, still fishing for information that might give us a clue about what was happening underwater. Any luck? He looked at a wide yellow band on his wrist.
My buddy is still down. Got about a minute left on this dive.
How long has he been under? I moved one step closer to the edge, peering into the blue, blue water.
30 minutes,
he said.
Then it's my turn again.
Very deep, I suppose, I said, still fishing.
Some say the pit is bottomless.
He smiled.
Actually, it's probably around 200 feet at the deepest point. We're looking at around 100 to 150.
Why there?
The tipster who contacted the chief said the car went into the water from up there.
Officer Andrews pointed upward to the mountain of gray stone looming over our heads.
Probably the same tip you got, huh? We figure we know about where it might have landed.
He waved the hand holding the mask.
God only knows how many cars have been ditched down there in that murky mess.
Ditched? I asked.
Sure, for the insurance money. Of course, not all of them have human remains inside.
Chapter 2. I tried not to look surprised. Francine didn't even try, just kept on filming, eyes wide, mouth open. Fortunately, our new diver friend had already flipper-flopped down to the next level of the ledge, about a foot closer to the water, and was no longer paying attention to us. Bubbles appeared on the surface, a few at first, then a veritable flood of them. Like some otherworldly sea creature, a second diver wearing a mask with huge insect-like lenses and protruding mouthpiece burst through their foamy center and launched himself onto the granite ridge at his fellow officer's feet. He yanked the mask off.
Got it! He shouted. 120. She's stuck sideways under a big chunk of rock. Gonna be a pisser to get out of there. Hard hat guys and a crane will have to take over.
He noticed us then, jerking a gloved thumb in our direction.
Who are they?
TV news people, Andrews said.
Oh boy, the chief's not gonna like that.
He looked away, ignoring us, removed his flippers, then lifted a small yellow camera from a pocket.
Got a few pictures. Wicked dark down there, though.
Yeah, tell me about it. Could you tell what color it is?
Andrews seemed to be ignoring us, too. Francine kept filming. I kept recording.
Couldn't tell much, but I'm pretty sure it's an old Mustang. Still got that little horse on the front grill. Maroon or red, maybe?
Sea monster diver looked in our direction.
You girls better run along now. Nothing to see here.
She's Mandello's girlfriend, Andrews offered. Did you see, you know, anything inside?
Not much. Anyway, if there was a body there, wouldn't be much left of it by now, would there? Listen, Chief's gonna be steamed if this winds up on television.
He frowned.
Say, this isn't one of those live shot things, is it?
I ducked the mic behind my back.
No, sir.
Good thing it isn't.
Say, how'd you get onto us being here anyway?
They're gathering material, Andrews said, quoting me. He had removed his flippers and tucked them under his arm.
They got a tip, same as the chief.
Not exactly the same, but sort of true.
Sea monster diver scowled.
Does Mandello know you're here?
I bristled at that. Of course not.
Well, you two better scram out of here. We have a permit. I'm guessing you don't.
He didn't wait for an answer, and with a quick shake of his head, motioned for Andrews to follow him. The two men stepped easily over the two ledges onto the edge of the field and disappeared into the maple tree grove. Francine and I picked our cautious way across the rough granite ridge, slippery from the divers' dripping wetsuits.
You sure my kitchen countertop started out like this crap?
Francine grumbled as we made our way over the final outcropping and onto the field.
I know, I said. Not so pretty close up, is it? And imagine someone deliberately driving off that huge cliff.
Kids used to jump off of it all the time, she said. That's why they have all the no swimming signs.
We'd reached the Chevy where the divers, who'd stripped down to t-shirts and shorts, were busy stowing their gear into a long metal locker in the truck bed. Andrews looked up and gave a little salute.
Nice to see you again, Ms. Barrett, he said. I'll tell Pete we ran into you.
Thanks, officer, I said, forcing a smile.
Pete might not be too happy about me messing around with police business. He worries about me.
Too bad. Police business is also news business. Francine and I trudged across the weedy terrain, Francine grumbling and me sneezing. Darn goldenrod. We were only about halfway to the top of the rut-filled excuse for a road we hadn't dared to drive on when we heard the Chevy start up.
Think they'll give us a lift down to the van? I wondered.
Doubt it.
Francine was still scowling.
They'll probably be in trouble for telling us anything about what they were doing.
Which wasn't much, I said. Enough for a teaser, maybe. Let's take what we've got back to the station and get Marty McCarthy to edit. She's the best. Have to take out the part about Pete and all the dead air. The most interesting thing is that they're looking for a body. Or remains of one. I'll do a voiceover. Explain that it's an ongoing investigation.
Why don't you just call Pete? She said. Maybe he'll tell you what they're looking for. And who they're looking for.
Maybe I will. And maybe I won't. The Chevy passed us with both divers looking straight ahead.
See? Francine sputtered. Told you they wouldn't stop. Big jerks. But look, they must have cut the barbed wire over there. Let's follow them. At least we won't have to climb through it.
They probably didn't have room for us with all that equipment, I reasoned. Anyway, I don't think police are supposed to transport random people unless there's a problem. We changed direction and followed the path the Chevy had taken. It was downhill, and without the barbed wire seemed much easier than the way we'd come up. The WICH-TV van was a welcome sight, and we hurried toward it. We stowed the mic and camera, then climbed into the front seats, Francine behind the wheel. I pulled a notebook and pen from a side door pocket and stared at a blank page.
I wish I knew more about diving, I said as we pulled away from the curb.
Ever try it yourself?
Just some snorkeling down in the Keys, I said.
You?
Sure. I'm certified.
No kidding. I should have let you ask the questions.
Not me. I like my side of the camera better than yours. You did great. I like the way you acted as though we were actually supposed to be there.
One of the first things I learned. It fools most people. I couldn't have faked it much longer, though. I'm going to have to do a lot of research on this one.
For instance?
Hard hats and a crane, the man said. I need to know exactly what a hard hat is and how a crane works.
My phone buzzed, and I smiled when caller ID revealed my Aunt Ibby's name.
Hi, I said. What's up?
Hello, Merrily. Where are you right now?
Route 128?
Perfect, she said. Do you have time to stop in Gloucester for a minute?
I looked at Francine and mouthed, Gloucester? She nodded, okay. It's a little out of the way, but sure we can, I told my aunt. What do you need?
My class reunion committee is coming over this evening, and I haven't had time to bake. Could you stop by Virgilio's and pick up a dozen cannoli and a dozen of those cute Italian cookies?
On the open page, I wrote, Virgilio's, 12 cannoli, 12 cookies.
A dozen of each. That all?
Yes, dear, thank you. I have to go back to the station for a while. See you a little after 5, okay?
Perfect.
And Aunt Ibby, if you have a minute, would you check and see if we have any books on diving? Scuba diving? I'm working on a story.
I'm sure we must, she said. 797, I should think. I'll check on it.
Not many home libraries are arranged according to the Dewey Decimal System, but ours is. We said our goodbyes, and Francine looked over at my notes.
Virgilio's? Cannoli and cookies? Somebody having a party?
Class reunion. My aunt's 45th. There's a committee meeting at our house tonight.
Oh, my God. That's so cute! A bunch of old people drinking tea and eating cookies and looking at their yearbook pictures.
I shook my head. I don't ever think of Aunt Ibby as old. Her hair is still red, her figure still a trim size 10, and her computer skills are amazing. I haven't met her classmates yet, I said, but I understand that one of the men was a star hockey player and another was a basketball coach at Boston College. Oh yeah, one of the women still models in TVT commercials, and one guy is running for Congress. Not too stodgy a group, I guess.
Wow, cool. I'll bet there aren't any coaches or congressmen in that bunch of party animals I graduated with.
Francine grinned.
Think you'll get to meet them all tonight?
I think so. I mean, I won't be sitting in on the meeting, but I guess I'll at least be introduced around the table. We'd arrived in nearby Gloucester, and Francine double-parked on the narrow street while I ran into the bakery.
Get me a loaf of that Italian bread, too, please, she called after me. I can smell it from here.
She was right. I succumbed to the fresh bread aroma and bought a loaf for myself along with Aunt Ibby's treats. If Pete came over after work, we'd have it with the nice olive oil bread dip I'd finally mastered. I ordered a dozen of the cute cookies for us, too. Francine had already sent our material ahead, so when we arrived back at the station, Marty and Wally, one of the production guys, were already set up and waiting for us. I was glad to see Marty. We'd worked together many times. Actually, my first and short-lived job at WICH-TV had been as the late-night show call-in psychic. The show was Nightshades. I dressed as a fortune teller and called myself Crystal Moon. It had been pretty much a disaster in every sense of the word, but Marty had proven to be a good and trusted friend, even though she still occasionally called me Moon.
You kids had a busy day so far, huh?
Marty asked, gray curls bobbing as she tapped and twirled myriad dials facing a triple screen monitor.
I don't suppose we can get hold of the pictures that diver took, could we?
I kind of doubt it. He wasn't too happy to see us. I guess you could tell that. I peered at the first screen, where Francine had recorded our ungraceful trek across the field toward the blue Chevy. Officer Andrews was okay about us being there, but the guy with the camera, not so much.
A real grouch, that one, Francine said. One of those by-the-book cops. Can't bend the rules for anybody. Never does anything outside the box. Even asked us if we had a permit to be there.
I didn't comment on that. Pete is one of those by-the-book cops, too. And sometimes I'm so far outside the box, it's a wonder he puts up with me.
The North Shore Pits.
Wally leaned toward the second screen, where the soaring gray granite walls Francine had found so beautiful appeared. They still looked menacing to me.
I used to go there when I was a kid, he said. Jumped off one of those 70-footers once on a dare.
He pointed.
That one right there, I think.
No kidding?
Marty gave him a playful punch on the arm. 70 feet?
Yep. Caught a little edge of granite just when I hit the water. Tore a furrow down the side of my leg. Want to see the scar?
He reached for his right pant leg. Three of us spoke at once. No thanks.
A lot of blood, he said. Whole lot of blood.
So, what's all that about a body, Moon?
Marty asked.
We lost some sound when you stuck the mic behind your back. Did we miss anything there?
Not a thing, I said. From what little they told us, it's been down there a long time, though. Marty nodded.
I think we'll do a little post-production magic with the green screen. For your intro, you'll stand in front of that footage of the pit showing the highest side.
She pointed to the middle monitor.
Beautiful shot, by the way, Francine. We won't use any of the sound, though. Maybe dub in a few birds. None of the conversation with the divers. Action shots only, like the guy coming up out of the water. Jeez, that was great. You'll do the voiceover, Lee. Just facts. This'll be really short. Just a teaser. 1-2 minutes tops. We'll try to jam it in at the bottom of the 5 o'clock news.
Got it, I said. Let me make a few notes. I have a fondness for lined index cards for note-taking and always have a stack of them handy.
Right, Marty said. Not too much about the body. And do something with your hair.
Chapter 3. I already had a general idea about the high points of our excursion that I could use in the teaser. Not that there was a lot to work with. We'd had a tip that some police divers were looking for something in the abandoned granite pit. That turned out to be true. We learned that the search was for a car and that they believed they'd found it. It was an old vehicle, a Ford, probably a Mustang, and maybe red or maroon. The most important thing was that they had reason to believe it contained human remains. I made some notes, then scribbled about half of them out.
Not too much about the body,
Marty had said. I wished I knew more about hard hat divers and giant cranes. And I wished I knew exactly what to do about my hair. It took longer than I'd thought it might, but after 15 minutes with the edited footage on the monitor, another 10 writing a script, 5 more taming curls gone wild, I was in front of the green screen. I'm Lee Barrett, at the site of a long-abandoned granite pit. There was some police activity here this morning, and WICH-TV will be on hand to keep you up to date as this story unfolds. At Marty's signal, I stepped away from the green screen, watching the monitor where a smiling Officer Andrews gestured toward the water and the 101 strings played Summertime softly. A few birds chirped. I began my voice over. Two scuba divers from the Salem Police Department spent part of the morning below the surface of the deep pool of fresh water you see here. Reputed to be 200 feet deep, this area has been closed to swimmers for many years, largely out of concern for young daredevils who dove from those towering 70-foot granite cliffs. According to a WICH-TV source, this morning's underwater investigation concerns an automobile which may have long ago plunged from one of those precipices into the depths below. The car in question may be a vintage red Mustang. And I paused here for effect. There may be human remains inside. Stay tuned to WICH-TV for more developments in this ongoing story. Marty signaled cut, and I looked at the studio clock.
Good job, she said. 1 minute, right on the button.
Lucky we got that much, I said. They didn't give us a lot to work with.
Just enough to make the audience want more, she said. Doan will love it.
She shrugged.
Of course, now you have to get to work and find out who the car belongs to and who the stiff is.
Francine snickered.
You were just saying how you want to learn more about diving. Here's your big chance.
You're both right, I agreed. I'll start doing a little reading tonight.
And maybe later I'll see what Pete has to say about it.
Fat chance he'll say anything. Just put on his cop face and tell me he can't discuss police business.
Francine snapped her fingers.
Hey, I'll see if my roomie can get the number of her brother's trainer. Maybe the guy overheard some more dirt at that dive shop.
Yeah, do it. Don's going to expect a follow-up on this.
He's going to expect it pronto.
Marty watched the teaser while I looked over her shoulder. It looked pretty good. Even my hair.
This is perfect for now, she said. We'll run this on the 5 o'clock and again at 11 tonight. Don will want to know a lot more by tomorrow, though. This little bit will tip off the other stations to what's happening over there.
Tomorrow? Oh, boy. No problem, I lied. We're on it. It was a few minutes before 5 when Francine and I clocked out in the second floor reception area. Rhonda, the way smarter than she looks receptionist, glanced up from her People magazine.
Hi, kids. Here you are over at the pits today. Something exciting happening over there?
I'm not sure yet, I admitted. Right now, it's just interesting. Some divers found an old car underwater. But if they find there's somebody dead inside the car, that's when it gets exciting.
Rhonda put her magazine down. You mean people are still diving off those high cliffs? I think that's against the law.
Not people, Francine said. Not regular people, anyway. It's police department scuba divers, and they were down on the low part.
Oh, they're looking for a body in there?
Human remains, they called it, I said. But one of the divers said there wouldn't be much left of it.
So they'll have to pull the car out of the pit so they can look inside?
Rhonda's eyes looked even bigger than usual.
So they can get whoever is in it out?
We think so. I headed for the door. We'll know more tomorrow.
I hope we'll know more tomorrow.
One of the divers said we might need a permit to go in there. It's posted with no trespassing signs.
It's posted with no everything signs, Francine added.
Right, it is. Rhonda, can you check with City Hall and see if you can get us permission to be at the site by tomorrow morning?
Pretty sure I can, she said. I know people.
I had no doubt about Rhonda's ability to get things done. Super. See you in the morning.
See you then.
Francine and I rode in the ancient elevator down to the lobby, crossed the black and white tiled floor, stepped out onto Derby Street, and walked together to the parking lot. She carried her wrapped loaf of Italian bread under one arm. As she opened the door to her truck, she looked back at me.
Just what is it we're going to do tomorrow?
If you can find out how to get in touch with that dive shop, maybe we'll start there, I said. I'll see what I can find out about what the police already know, and we'll probably go back to the pit and see if there's any heavy equipment there yet. It probably will take a pretty big crane to lift up an automobile.
Yep, they won't be able to hide it. Good photo op, even if we don't get to see the remains.
She closed her truck door and rolled down the window.
What do remains look like, exactly?
I shrugged. Bones, maybe?
Oh, jeez. What a great shot that would be. A skeleton behind the wheel. Awesome. See you in the morning.
I climbed into my almost new Laguna Blue Corvette Stingray. I know the car is a bit much for a fledgling reporter, but the income from my parents' estate totals far more than my salary at WICH-TV will ever be, and the vet was a rare extravagance. I put the paper bags from Virgilio's onto the seat beside me and took a deep breath of the fresh bread aroma filling the car. The late afternoon sun lent a golden glow to the harbor beyond the granite seawall as I backed out of the lot onto Derby Street and headed for home. I parked in the garage behind our house on Winter Street, picked up the 2 bags of bakery treats, and started along the brick pathway leading to the back door. Spring flowers bloomed behind the wrought iron fence surrounding Aunt Ibby's garden. Hydrangea, Queen Anne's lace, lilacs, violets,
for Scythia. As I approached the steps, a cat door popped open, and our big, yellow-striped male cat, Orion, rushed out to greet me with loud purrs and happy "Aww," wrapping himself around my ankles. I bent to pat him, pulled keys from my purse, unlocked the door, and stepped into our downstairs back hall. Orion immediately ducked through another cat entrance, this one leading into my Aunt Ibby's kitchen. I deposited my bags of bread and cookies on the nearby stairs leading up to my third-floor apartment, put the one containing the cannoli and cookies under my arm, and knocked on her door. "It's me, Aunt Ibby. I've got your goodies." "Come right in, Merrily. It's open," she called. My aunt's kitchen is a wonderfully warm, welcoming place. Visitors usually wind up there, in comfortable captain chairs at her round oak table, sipping coffee, tea, or wine. I put the bags on the long butcher block counter and gave her a hug. "You look pretty," I told her. "All ready for your classmates?" "Thank you, dear. Yes, I think so." She patted her hair, smoothed the skirt of her pale green silk dress, and opening the door of a glass-fronted china cabinet, removed two platters. "I'm thinking of using the Spode Blue Indigo porcelain for the cookies and the Blue Willow for the cannoli. What do you think?" "They're perfect, of course. And let me guess, Grandmother Forbes's flow blue china plates and cups?" "Exactly. And the cobalt wine glasses." She gestured toward the oak table. "There'll be just six of us, so I think we'll do the plotting and planning at the big table in the dining room, and then come out here for refreshments." "Do you need any help? What time do you expect them?" I asked. 6 o'clock, she said, glancing at her watch. "And it's past 5 already. You could help me arrange these lovely pastries on the platters so I can just pull them out of the refrigerator when it's time to eat." "Glad to," I said, reaching for the blue willow. "I'll do the cannoli. Want to turn on the news? Francine and I did a little teaser story that should be on pretty soon." "A teaser? How fascinating. I never get over what a delight it is to see you on TV." She picked up the remote, and the small wall-mounted TV clicked on. Phil Archer, the evening news anchor, does the half-hour show on weeknights. He'd just begun a piece on shelter pets, highlighted with video of adorable puppies and kittens. Orion looked up from his red bowl of kibble, watching intently. He likes kittens. Aunt Ibby had finished arranging her cookie platter and had already begun covering it with plastic wrap, while I still debated about which way to angle the sugar-dusted tubes with their creamy fillings on mine. "I'll just put these in the fridge," she said. "Oh, look! There you are." She paused on her way to the Frigidaire, watching the screen. Francine had filmed me from the back as I trudged across the weed-filled field. "Where in the world were you?" "At the old North Shore Granite Works." "Watch, it gets better," I promised, as I finished my cannoli arrangements. "Look, scuba divers." We watched together, and I heard my own voice. "According to a WICH-TV source, this morning's underwater investigation concerns an automobile, which may have long ago plunged from one of those precipices into the depths below. The car in question may be a vintage red Mustang, and there may be human remains inside." I heard the crash as the Spode platter shattered. Colorful cookies rolled among blue and white porcelain shards on the tile floor. My aunt stood over the wreckage, green eyes wide, complexion ashen. Chapter 4. I reached for her arm and led her to a chair. "What's wrong? Are you okay?" She made a helpless gesture toward the mess on the floor. "Don't worry about that," I said, taking her hand. "I'll sweep it up. Your hands are freezing. What is it?" She was silent for a long moment. I rubbed her hands, felt her forehead, watched as the color came back into her face. "Aunt Ibby," I whispered, "do you feel better now?" She suddenly sat erect, pulling her hands away, folding them in her lap.
Oh dear, Merrily. I've broken that lovely platter. It's part of a set, you know. How clumsy of me. Here, I'll clean it up. I expect all the pretty cookies are ruined, too.
She attempted to stand, but I held her shoulders. Please, sit for a minute. I peered into her eyes. I'll sweep it up. There's a china replacement store in Boston. We can get another platter. She shook her head and gave an apologetic smile.
I'm such a klutz, and carrying on like that over a dish and some cookies. I'm embarrassed. Not like me at all, is it? Must be what they call a senior moment.
It wasn't one bit like her, and I didn't like to think about her having a senior moment. Does this portend anything serious going on in her mind? I shook the dreadful thought away. Within minutes, the sparkle was back in the green eyes. Her smile was sincere and genuine, and when I released my grip on her shoulders, she stood as gracefully as ever. You just sit back down and take it easy for a minute, I said, pulling the broom and dustpan from the utility closet. Have a nice cup of tea and relax. I swept up the debris and dumped it into a wastebasket, while my aunt quietly, and surprisingly, did exactly as I'd suggested. She microwaved a cup of water, dunked a tea bag into it, and calmly took a seat at the round oak table. Orion climbed onto her lap, and she stroked his fuzzy head with one hand, stirring the tea with the other. I bought an extra dozen cookies, I said, still watching her closely. And I have a pretty Wedgwood hibiscus platter upstairs. Not old, but it'll go with your blue theme. If you'll be all right for a minute, I'll run up and get it.
That's so thoughtful of you, dear, she said. Yes, thank you. And you bought extra cookies? How fortuitous.
Couldn't resist them, I said. Now, you just take it easy. I'll be right back. I glanced at the clock on the wall. 5:30. The TV was still on, but the newscast was over. A Golden Girls rerun was playing, one of my aunt's favorite shows. With the tea, Bea Arthur, and the cat on her lap, she'd probably stay put for the couple of minutes it'd take me to run upstairs and grab the platter. I snatched the bakery bag from the bottom of the staircase and raced up two twisty flights of stairs to my apartment. Unlocking my door, I passed through the living room, hurried down the narrow hall to the kitchen, and threw open the door to my china cabinet. The platter was at the bottom of a pile of serving pieces that had to be removed carefully, one by one. Leaving graduated bowls, soup tureen, cream pitcher, and sugar bowl in an untidy cluster on top of my lucite kitchen table, I picked up the box of cookies and balanced it on top of the platter. The kitchen door offered a faster route back down to the first floor, so, heart pounding, carrying platter and cookies, I raced down the wide and quite handsome oak staircase, curving gently from the third floor landing down to a spacious foyer opening into Aunt Ibby's living room. I slowed down and approached her kitchen at a more decorous pace. My aunt had stayed pretty much exactly as I'd left her, except the teacup was empty and Orion had moved to a chair beside her. "Feeling better?" I asked, placing the platter carefully on the table. She reached across and touched it.
What? Oh, yes, I'm fine. Just feel a bit silly. Lucky you bought extra cookies. And the Wedgwood is perfect. Oh, my, look at the time. They'll be here soon.
She stood, smoothed her dress, and carried her teacup to the sink.
Want to arrange the cookies while I freshen up a bit?
She headed for the little powder room off the kitchen.
Sure,
I said, still watching her carefully. What am I so worried about? She dropped a darned plate of cookies. Big deal. I rinsed and dried the platter. It had, after all, been in my china cabinet, unused for a couple of years. It was wedding china, and I just hadn't felt like using it since my husband Johnny died. I arranged the cookies, covered the platter with plastic wrap, and put it into the refrigerator beside the cannoli.
The front doorbell chimed the impossible dream, and I looked around for my aunt. Her voice issued from the powder room. "Would you get that, Marilee? I'll be there in a minute." I passed the dining room on my way to the living room and the foyer, turning on lights along the way. Peeking into the room, I smiled at the way Aunt Ibby had arranged materials on the long mahogany table. Pens, markers, paper, glue sticks, tape. It reminded me of my middle school project days. Orion had reached the front hall before I did, his pink nose pressed against the narrow window next to the door. A quick look through the same window revealed a tall man with a good tan and a neatly trimmed gray beard. I recognized him from newspaper pictures. He was Steve Overton, one of my aunt's most successful classmates, class president 45 years ago, and now a candidate for the U.S. Congress. I pulled open the door. "Hello, please come in. My aunt will be here in a moment." I stuck out my hand. "I'm her niece, Lee Barrett." "Steve Overton," he said, shaking my hand vigorously. "So very pleased to meet you. Ibby speaks so highly of you." "Did I hear my name? Hello, Steve." My aunt appeared in the living room's arched entrance.
"Ibby,"
he said, holding out both arms and moving toward her.
"As lovely as ever."
They did one of those over-the-shoulder air kiss things people their age do. He was right. She looked absolutely lovely, without the slightest hint of her recent senior moment, or whatever the heck that thing was.
"I see you've met my niece," she said. "Perhaps you recognize her from television."
"I do indeed,"
he said, turning to face me once again.
"I expect I'll be seeing you fairly often, young lady. I've been working on an advertising schedule with Bruce Doan, running for a congressional seat, you know."
I nodded, smiling, and turned back to the door as the bell chimed again.
"That'll be Betsy," my aunt said, reaching for the doorknob. "I saw her Mercedes pull up a minute ago."
Betsy Leavitt was the tea commercial model. Aunt Ibby had pointed her out to me several times, always on the big national channels, not the locals like WICH-TV. Betsy whirled into the foyer in a cloud of Chanel Gabrielle and Oscar de la Renta black silk.
"Ibby! Oh, Ibby, what a joy to see you!"
The two women hugged, and Betsy turned to me.
"You're Marilee! You look like your mother," she said, with a dazzling smile that showed why the tea company liked her. "So pretty."
"Thank you. You knew my mother?"
"Of course. Ibby's little sister, Carrie."
She flashed that professional model smile again and extended a perfectly manicured hand to the aspiring congressman.
"Hi, Steve."
He took her hand.
"Hi, Betts," he said.
"I have the dining room set up for our projects." My aunt beckoned her friends to join her. "It's almost 6 now, so the others should be along any minute. I'd like to start on time. We have so much to accomplish. Marilee, will you mind the door for us and direct the others to the dining room?"
"Sure, glad to."
Orion had hopped onto the seat of our antique hall tree, which is quite a spectacular piece of furniture. It's about 8 feet tall, made of walnut with age-darkened metal hooks at various heights along both sides of a big, bevel-edged mirror. The seat is convenient for pulling on or taking off boots, and it lifts up for storage. The mirror is handy for a last-minute check of your appearance before admitting guests. All in all, a well-designed and useful item. I took a quick glance in the mirror, wishing I'd had a chance to change from jeans and a pale blue cotton sweater to something more appropriate.
Oh, well.
I gave my hair a token fluffing, nudged the cat gently, sat beside him, and waited for 3 more members of Salem High School's class of 1974 to arrive. My phone buzzed. "Hi, Pete. What's up?"
"Chief's on a tear. How come you..."
The doorbell chimed. "Hold on a sec. I said, standing. Gotta answer the door. Reaching for the doorknob, I glanced again at the mirror. Big mistake. In an instant, I saw the flashing lights and swirling colors. I'm what's known in paranormal circles as a scryer. My friend, River North, calls me a gazer. River happens to be a witch, and she knows all about such things. Anyway, I'd found out fairly recently that I have the weird ability to see things in shiny objects. Things that have happened, or are happening, and even things that could happen in the future. River calls it a gift. I don't think of it that way. It had come in handy a few times, but mostly all it had shown me was death and dying. And the visions always start with those damned flashing lights and swirling colors. Chapter 5. Fast priority assessment. First, answer the door. Next, see what Pete wants. Finally, hope that whatever's in the mirror goes away. Two more of Aunt Ibby's classmates had arrived. A very tall man who had to be the basketball coach, and a tiny, by comparison, blonde woman. I welcomed the pair, introduced myself, and learned that the coach was Warren Whipple.
You can call me Coach, sweetheart.
And the woman was Penelope Driscoll, who, she informed me, had been friends with my aunt since first grade and had brought along her yearbook so that they could copy the high school pictures for name tags.
Some of us have changed a little since 74, she said with a shy smile. It might help to have a photo to jog the old memory.
Good idea, I said, and escorted the pair to the dining room. I'd be interested to see that old yearbook myself. I wondered if Aunt Ibby had kept hers. I was pretty sure I'd never seen one around the house. The arrival at the table of Coach and Penelope produced another round of hugs, greetings, and air kisses. That made five. One more classmate to go. I excused myself, returned to the bench, and, carefully avoiding the mirror, pulled my phone from my pocket. You still there, Pete?
Yes, what's going on?
Tonight's Aunt Ibby's class reunion committee meeting. Bunch of people coming over.
Oh yeah, I'd forgotten about that. Listen, what I was trying to tell you, Chief Whaley says you were over at the pits interfering in police business. Then Andrews tells me he saw you there, and you were taking pictures and recording him and his partner. That right?
Pete was using what I call his cop voice. That means serious stuff. Francine and I were following a tip about SPD looking for something underwater over there. That's all. Why? I knew that sounded a little defensive, and I tried to soften my tone. We didn't learn much of anything.
Well, when the chief got hold of it, he got on the horn with your boss and told him not to air any of whatever you got.
Uh-oh, too late. And he found out we'd already aired it on the 5 o'clock?
Right. He's not happy.
Chief Tom Whaley is rarely happy with me. I seem to get on his wrong side more often than not. It's been that way since practically the minute we met, right after I discovered Ariel Constellation's body floating in Salem Harbor. Ariel was a witch, and Orion used to be her cat. Some say he was her familiar, and in Salem, a witch's familiar is always respected, and sometimes feared. Did Mr. Doan agree to spike the story?
I can't believe he did.
Just for tonight's 11 o'clock news, Pete admitted. How much do you have about what they're looking for anyway?
Red Mustang with possible human remains, I said. Wedged sideways down about 120 feet. They're going to need hard hat divers and a crane to get at it.
No kidding.
I could hear the smile in his voice.
You're getting pretty good at this, babe.
Really? That's not very much to go on, is it?
It's a pretty darn good start, if you ask me.
Short pause.
But you're not going to ask me, right?
Come on over after work, I said, in my best Marilyn Monroe imitation. I'll ply you with fresh Italian bread and the dipping sauce you like. Maybe even some wine.
Ice cream, too?
Absolutely. Want to pick up an antipasto at Bertini's on your way?
Sure. I'll get out of here around 8, he said. But seriously, you know I can't discuss police business with you.
It's also news reporter business, Pete. You know I'll be poking around, looking for information.
I know. See you in a couple of hours. Love you. Bye.
Love you too. Bye. I checked the phone for messages. River North wanted me to call her ASAP. River is not only my best friend, but a fellow employee at WICH-TV. After my unfortunate experience as a phony phone-in psychic on Nightshades, River, a tearing beauty and an expert tarot reader, took over that late-night time slot. Tarot Time with River North became one of the station's top-rated shows. Still deliberately avoiding looking at the mirror, I remained at my post by the front door. I'd call River just as soon as the tardy classmate showed up. At 6:20, Aunt Ibby appeared at the dining room doorway.
"Looks like Bobby couldn't make it, dear," she called. "You go along upstairs. If he shows up, I'll let him in. Thanks for your help."
"No problem." I stood facing the stairway. Orion left the bench and padded across the living room to follow her. "Will you need me in the kitchen later?"
"Nope, we'll be fine. You've had a busy day. See you in the morning."
"Have a good meeting," I said. "Good night." She and Orion disappeared into the dining room. I started up the stairs, then thought I heard a car pull up. Has the missing Bobby arrived? I turned back toward the door, toward the mirror. The swirling colors and flashing lights had stopped, but the vision was stark and clear. Moonlight shone on dark water, etching shadowy designs on the face of the gray cliffs. Then, as if in slow motion, a car lurched from the highest point, slowly revolving as it fell. The picture faded away before the vehicle hit the water. Too dark to see color or details, but I had no doubt that the damned thing was red, and that there was a little horse on the front grill. The doorbell chimed. Reaching for the doorknob, I shoved the vision out of my mind. I was getting pretty good at doing that. The man standing outside was slim, with salt-and-pepper hair, big brown eyes, a warm smile, and a strong smell of alcohol.
"Hi there," he said, stepping inside and offering his hand. "I'm Bobby Ross. Have they started the party without me?"
I shook his hand, dodging the fumes. "Just getting started," I said. "I'm Lee Barrett, Ibby Russell's niece. Come on, I'll show you where they are."
"Hello, Lee Barrett," he said, falling into step beside me. "You look like her, like Ibby's sister."
"Thank you," I said.
"Here you go."
The group gathered around the table called out happy greetings. Steve pulled out a chair and motioned for Bobby to sit next to him.
"Glad you could make it, Bobby. You're looking good."
There was a chorus of,
"Good to see you,"
and, "How is San Francisco?" and,
"You haven't changed much."
I gave my aunt a little wave and started for the stairs again with Orion tagging along behind me. I dared a glance at the mirror. Nothing there but my own reflection. I hurried up the 2 flights. Even though the apartment was in the house where I was raised, the space my aunt had designed for me was uniquely my own. It felt like home. From the 1970s Lucite table and chairs, set to the vintage Fiesta ware in the kitchen, the glass-fronted barrister's bookcase in the living room, to the chest of drawers with secret compartments in my bedroom, I was surrounded by things that made me happy. A glance at the Kit Kat clock on the wall told me I had an hour or so to return River's call, get a shower, and change clothes, if I was going to be presentable, with warmed Italian bread and fresh dipping sauce on hand when Pete arrived. A little multitasking was in order.
Once in the bathroom, I put the phone on speaker and hit River's number. "Hi, River, you called?" I began to strip off my clothes and put them into the laundry chute.
"I did. Saw you on the news in that creepy place."
"You think it's creepy, too? Francine thinks it's beautiful."
"Yeah, well, different strokes."
"Listen," she said, using her on-the-air card reader voice.
"It creeped me out enough that I did a reading for you. I need to talk to you about it."
I turned on the shower and stuck my hand into the stall, testing the temperature.
"Hey, you're not in the shower, are you?"
"Not yet. Pete's coming over. Can the reading wait until tomorrow?"
"It can."
She dropped her voice.
"But Lee, I think this one might be really important. Tomorrow, for sure?"
"Now you're creeping me out. But yes, for sure," I promised. Later, showered, dressed, hair brushed, and even blushed and glossed, I had a few spare minutes to check the 797 shelf in the study for books on scuba diving. Orion followed me into the book-lined room, but spent his time looking at the occupants of Aunt Ibby's saltwater aquarium, swimming languidly in and out of a turreted castle and over treasure chests. I found two books that looked helpful, called The Cat, and closed the study door and returned to my apartment. Orion ran to the living room door as soon as he heard Pete's key turn in the lock, and I was right behind him. I'd changed into a new cotton mini dress in a cheerful sunny yellow with some cute white Birkenstock sandals. The look of approval in his dark eyes told me I'd made a good choice. He put the Bertini's bag on the coffee table, and we exchanged a long, satisfying kiss.
"You smell good," he said, still holding me close.
"That might be the rosemary I put in the sauce," I said. "But thanks." After a little more kissing, we eventually made it to the kitchen. I arranged the antipasto in an orange bowl, slipped the bread into a brown paper bag, and popped it into the already warm oven while Pete started the coffee. "Chief Whaley isn't mad at you, is he?" I asked. "Because of me, I mean?"
"No, you know the chief. Barks worse than his bite. He just doesn't much like surprises. And this dumped car thing came right out of left field."
"Really?" I pulled the loaf of bread out of the oven and began slicing. "How so?"
"Anonymous tip. He hates 'em. Half the time they don't lead anywhere, and this one will be expensive to follow up on."
I thought about what little I knew about divers and cranes. He was right. Getting that car out of the water-filled granite pit would surely make a dent in the department's operating budget. He must think the tipster has some credibility, I suppose, if he's gone this far with it. Unapologetic fishing expedition. I set out plates, silverware, and wine glasses, and arranged thick bread slices.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.